stole my jazz mix. Lydia, you're welcome. We got some gotcha journalists.
Citizen journalists.
She's independent. Well, she is. That's the danger of Lydia. How you doing? Good to see you, Mr. Tisdale. You doing all right?
Good to see you.
How you're...
Have these little hair masks on?
Yes, hi. Good to see you. Nice to meet you in person. Know of you, of course, and see you on Twitter and...
Reverse order?
Reverse order.
I'm going to take it out of that.
Williams, Wingfield, and Williams. That sounds good.
James, do you want us to sit there?
Yes, among the people.
Okay,
among the people.
We're not elitist from that.
I'm Veronica Ingram. James.
Thank you.
Welfare and community standards. And we
seek to unite conservatives, Republicans, Tea Party patriots, Christians and evangelicals, independents, and community organizers, as well as constitutionalists and environmentalists. These groups have a lot in common. They're very like-minded, but sometimes they disagree on one issue or the other and fight among themselves instead of working together. So hopefully we can bridge that gap and encourage people to accomplish more together. Our guest speakers tonight are local political guru and talk show host, our radio host, Greg Williams, Atlanta Journal-Constitution columnist, Kyle Wingfield, and Georgia State Senator Michael Williams. And each of them will come up to talk about their reflections from the Trump inauguration. Greg Williams and Senator Williams were there in Washington to witness the event. And Mr. Wingfield was back home in Atlanta holding down the fort. But we understand that the AGC was amply represented in Washington. So without further ado, we're going to ask Greg Williams to come up and share his thoughts, and then Mr. Wingfield, and then Senator Wade.
All right, cool. I know you guys are probably going to want to do a lot of back and forth. James was able to put together a really cool panel here. I mean, we all were joking earlier, we would have been the last kids called on in the home room. We got Williams, and Wingfield. We had three W's, so clearly we were at the end of the alphabet. Last ones picked on the playground, so to speak. But I do a weekly radio show. In fact, Kyle and Michael have both been on several times to talk politics. Michael was he was the first legislator in the state of Georgia to get on the Trump train. And I was never Trumper, but I am admittedly a skeptic. In fact, every day I go on Facebook and I look at the on this day, and I go back and I delete a lot of the negative stuff that I said. I called him an undocumented Republican, and I regret that, obviously. And what we're seeing now, folks, is Donald Trump has given Republicans a spine, and that is so encouraging to me. And everybody that was holding their nose and voting for Trump, Republicans that did that for the Supreme Court, thank you. Thank you for doing that, because look what we have now. We have Neil Gorsuch as our nominee, and apparently Trump wanted people that, you know, whose name could also be in Star Wars for the Supreme Court. So today's Groundhog Day. You guys know that Punxsutawney Phil, when he's doing his meteorology, he only has a 39% success rate in his predictions. So apparently he's using the same pollster as Hillary Clinton. So we were up in D.C. I drove up with several Latins. My wife is from Ecuador. Her sister from Ecuador, both of them voted for Trump with me on November 8th, and then her nephew and her brother-in-law. So all of us are up there, and on the day before the inauguration on Thursday, they shut down all the streets. This is one of the best memories I'll ever have. I wasn't drinking, so I remember very well that we were literally walking along the road towards the Capitol, and my wife and her sister, their the son and the boyfriend, had these huge Donald Trump capes. One was Make America Great Again, the other was Trump. They're both wearing these pretty audacious wigs. So we're walking up, and it's just a scene from like a movie, like five people just kind of walking towards the Capitol, making America great again. And we keep getting interview requests from people, and everybody except me is from Ecuador. So they have a little bit of an accent. So when you should have seen the interview people's faces when they're saying, they're expecting probably some redneck accent. Instead, my wife is like, no, I'm supporting Trump because he's going to make America great again. Where are you from? Okay, I'm going to get the next person. Same thing. No, Trump is a man. Okay, next person. And then the green girl, I'm like, you want to hear from me? They're like, no, we're good. So I texted the folks the next day, hey, where's our interview at? Oh, the editor decided to not include your testimony. So we were censored, so to speak. I gotta tell you folks, the first first week of the Trump administration has been nothing short of amazing. Besides a few ill-advised tweets, I would say it's been a rousing success. Right? We've reassured a lot of our allies. Everybody that calls Trump a Nazi, first of all, that's hyperbolic. Second of all, he's way too friendly with Israel and Russia to be a Nazi. Think about it. But so we're having to deal with a hissy fit. Histrionics from the left. Last night you saw the people in Cal Berkeley. It was a gay protest if we wanted to spin it. But Milo,
Indianapolis.
Yes. See, I've already messed that up. I just say Milo for short. So he wants to speak at Cal Berkeley, and the liberals, you know, the sordid, I call it the alt-left, they want to call everybody that loves America and the promise of America the alt-right. So let's do it back to them. Let's call them the alt-left. They're not protesting, they're rioting, right? That's not free speech. So we have turned the Democrat Party into the extremists that they accused us of being back in 2010 when the Tea Party Revolution took over. And we have an amazing opportunity. I am a little leery. Republicans are getting a little gun shy about repealing Obamacare. And I get it, it's complicated. There's a lot of nuances that need to be done. We do need to protect the people that have had pre-existing conditions. We certainly don't want to just dump them back onto the streets. But, you know, now I'm seeing, though, we want to repair Obamacare as the narrative. And that's being tested by a lot of the moderate Republicans. I encourage you guys to make sure you give them a little bit of a spine and a backbone and say, repeal it and then figure it out. I know it can't be done overnight. Yeah.
Oh, we already repaired it. He's gone.
I was about to say.
That's a repair already.
Yeah, well, you're right. We did, we protested on Election Day, right? So my predictions going forward, because I know the other guys are going to have some scintillating information as well, and then y'all can ask all the questions. Well, my predictions going forward, we're in for a long protracted hissy fit about our Supreme Court nominee. If the Democrats are smart, they'll go ahead and realize that this is a trade for trade, and Ruth Bader Ginsburg ain't getting any younger, and that's when they should hold their powder to fight that. If they really mess up this one, then Donald Trump is going to have a chance to nominate not just Gorsuch, but two or three other. And he's not going to care about going slightly moderate. He's going to say, you guys, you know, wasted all your political capital fighting this guy, who his pedigree is amazing. He was unanimously confirmed by the Senate back in 2006 to get his current job. So he's clearly qualified. So if they want to, you know, die on their, or fall on their sword for this one, they're really screwed going forward. So let's kind of hope they do that. But at any rate, well, I'll be around for questions. My show is on americaswebradio.com from 2 to 3 on Tuesdays. I do a lot of speaking. I've been the chair of the Buckhead Young Republicans. In fact, that's how I met James. We used to do a lot of our happy hours at Fidel, and I probably will be talking and going there to have a celebratory beer afterwards with a couple of my friends. So thank you, guys, and I'll be around, okay?
It's been great, bro. Can you please sit at the end?
Yes.
So we can have some back and forth.
And now Nydia won't be filming my bald spot. Perfect.
Do any of you have any questions for Greg?
Why were you skeptical originally?
I mean, I was believing the polls, and I thought, and he actually outperformed in every smaller segment than Mitt Romney, and I did not think that was possible.
That was the reason. I didn't know if it was because you were a Cruz person or if you were anything. I was just wondering what was your original sketch.
I was a Scott Walker guy. In fact, the day that they were going to announce the chairs, we got a call. Hey, Walker's dropping out. So I was like, please don't send out that press release. Let's just kind of tuck that away so we're not all embarrassed of being on the losing candidate. And then I was like, I'm bad luck to campaigns. So I was a silent Rubio supporter. And me and my wife voted for Rubio on the primary, and Donald Trump ended up getting 38% of the vote here. Rubio and Cruz had 25 each. And then I applied to be a delegate to the convention in Cleveland. And at that point, we were basically asked to do a loyalty pledge. And I had never, like I said, I was not a never Trumper. I firmly believe that whoever we had was going to be much better than Hillary Clinton. And I'm convinced that that's a fact, and we're seeing that play out right now. But that was it. And like I said, it was constructive criticism I had. I always tried to make it a little bit humorous, but I was never like, oh my God, Trump is evil incarnate. We can never have this man like some of our more self-righteous people that I'm sure all of you guys know.
Bill Crystal.
Well, I'm talking about our local Georgia people. I'm talking about the people that are giving Michael Williams hell. He stood out on the left. I mean, Kyle is, you know, not a never-Trumper either, but certainly me and Kyle had similar predictions for Donald Trump, and thank God they didn't pan out. I'm thinking that.
James?
Yes?
Hey, we've got a meeting, James. But yeah, thanks guys, but yeah, these next two speakers are going to be even better than me, so.
Okay, next we have Atlanta Journal Constitution columnist Kyle Wingfield, and he's going to talk about holding things down in Atlanta while some of his correspondents went to D.C. So, Kyle?
Thank you for having me here tonight. I did elect to stay back here. It was, first of all, we had 8 people going up, and I wasn't sure what else I was going to add to the coverage that they couldn't get on their own. And it was also my son's 8th birthday. He was born, I joke that he's bound to be a Republican because he showed up a week early on this earth to be born a few hours before George Bush left office on January 20th, 2009. So pretty sure we're going to have him in the fold. But I do plan to get up to D.C. sometime in the next month or two while they're working on legislation and try to do some reporting on whether it's Obamacare, tax reform, or whatever that might be. It has been a whirlwind couple of weeks, obviously. We have had widespread protests the last 2 weekends. I don't know who's organizing the protests this weekend. I assume there has to be something somewhere. That seems to be the MO. Definitely the all the lectures we heard throughout the election campaign about, well, you know, the results of the election have to be respected, and you know, elections have consequences and everything else. All the people who were saying that all fall have promptly forgotten every bit of that because they're.
It didn't apply to them.
I don't think Texas what we've seen is a respect for election results or the acknowledgement that they have consequences. But as for what President Trump's done so far, I think he's been very smart in trying to do as much as he can, as quickly as he can, and as early as he can. Obviously, he's been doing most everything so far through what he can through executive actions. I think, you know, that's smart to do while his cabinet confirmation process is playing out. By and large, I thought he did a very good job picking out his cabinet appointments. I thought he hit a home run with his Supreme Court nominee. I don't think, even those of us who were skeptical of him, in large part, and I'll go ahead and address that for myself, knowing his past political positions and the constant, it seemed, evolution of them, and wholesale evolution, I just didn't think that I could trust him to be a conservative president on a lot of issues. I will say that as we've seen on the Supreme Court anyway, he's definitely proven me wrong on that. That I think Neil Gorsuch is as good a pick as he could have made. Very pleased with that. I agree with Greg and wrote earlier this week the Democrats would be crazy to filibuster this nominee, not only because, any court nominee that a Republican president puts out is going to be called out of the mainstream by the Democrats. That's just what they do. But I think he's well within the judicial mainstream, certainly center or right of center of it. But yeah, I think the mainstream goes, you know, a little left of center and a little right of center. And I think he's squarely within that. He's certainly well qualified, very well respected by jurists on the left and the right. And as Greg was saying, if they provoke the GOP to kill the filibuster now, just wait to see the wailing and gnashing of teeth when the next justice leaves the court. And for the record, and I wish no one ill, but the oldest justice there is Ruth Bader Ginsburg, 83 years old. Next is Anthony Kennedy, who's 80, and the next is Stephen Breyer, 78. Then you drop all the way 10 years to Clarence Thomas. So if we look at the likelihood of where an opening would come from, it's going to be someone who is not a reliable conservative vote on the court at the moment. And as far as predictions, I got out of the predictions business last year. I will say that that's in large part because we've undergone a change. We've broken the paradigm that we were operating under before. And, you know, when you're trying to make predictions, especially about politics, you know, you look at what's happened in the past and you try to apply that to the current situation. Well, we've broken that paradigm to the point where the past is not prologue to what we're going through now. So there's really no basis for it. The opinion polling isn't definitive enough to tell you where you ought to look for where sentiment lies. So I'm not making any predictions. I will tell you that if I were advising the president on once he's done what he can through the executive actions and he's got his nominees confirmed, he's looking for that first big piece of legislation, if he's the deal maker that he says he is, the area I would look for is something on corporate taxes, which everyone acknowledges we need to do something to fix, left and right. President Obama talked about it. He didn't want to do exactly what we on the right would like to do, but he acknowledged that it needed changing. He's talked a lot about, you know, doing an infrastructure boost. Well, I would say we're going to lower the corporate tax rate, we're going to flatten it out, you know, get rid of some of the exemptions and everything. We've got that $2 trillion in profits of American companies parked overseas because they don't want to pay a 35% rate to bring it back. We're going to do a special repatriation rate for that money. We're going to see hundreds of billions, if not over $1 trillion, come back into the economy, which you think about $1 trillion in an $18 trillion economy, that's an enormous boost, right? That's like a 4 or 5% boost to GDP right there with that money getting invested. And then you say, and Democrats, to get you on board, we're going to take the proceeds of that repatriation tax and we're going to put it into the infrastructure program that we've been talking about that y'all want to. And tell both sides, if either one of you blinks, it's going to be on you. And this is something that the American people are going to like and that will give our economy a boost. And I tell you what, whatever people say about what the president is doing, you get growth back up to 4% for a year or two. 3%. Barack Obama is the first president since I can go back to the statistics who didn't have a single year of his presidency where we hit 3%. Jimmy Carter hit 3%. Okay? The statistics don't go all the way back through Herbert Hoover's administration, so I'm not sure about him. But ever since then, every president but Obama has hit 3% at least once. You get that growth back up to that, it will cover a multitude of other sins that people talk about. And like I say, no predictions because we're going to be on the grind at that point. So
thank you. Anyone have any questions for Mr. Wingfield?
I was going to ask you, didn't Clarence Thomas, wasn't he talking about retiring?
You know, someone else mentioned that to me. I don't know specifically what that reference was, but you know, if he were to retire, you know, I think certainly this would be another case where the high ground for appointing another, you know, reliable conservative to the court in his place is on the Republican side, just as it is in building Justice Scalia's.
The younger, the longer.
That's right.
President Gorsuch is 49 years old. It reminded me of, you remember Star Wars, when, like, I'm getting a new apprentice, but far younger. Remember that? So it's kind of like we traded in, you know, Scalia for somebody that's 50. He'll be on the court for 20 to 30 years. That's an amazing pick. And I'm excited about it.
People live longer now. It's probably 40. Probably 40 years.
We're going to keep this one healthy. Mm-hmm.
And away from honeymoon crowds.
Any other questions? Well, seeing none, our next presenter will be Georgia Senator Michael Williams. He went to Washington, D.C. to witness the inauguration, and he's going to give us his perspective and predictions for the next 90 days.
Thank you. It is a great pleasure and honor to be here with all of you today. As has been mentioned a couple times, and I am very, very proud of this. I was, in fact, the first elected official in all of Georgia to come out and endorse Donald Trump. Back in Georgia. September of 2015. So this is the heat of the primary. And like Greg said, I got beat up. I got accused of all kinds of different things. I'm relatively new to politics. Before I did this, I was a small business owner, owned a bunch of hair salons, and I just kind of out of the blue decided to run for office. So I had to go and scrounge up a bunch of supporters, and we beat an incumbent. So it was kind of hard in itself. But after I came out and endorsed Trump, I had some of my early supporters saying, "Michael, what the heck are you doing? We went on a limb to get you elected. Now you're doing this." Like, look, guys, just bear with me, be patient. I know the guy's kind of off his rock a little bit, but he's going to make sense here in a little bit. And hopefully I'll be able to add some of the comments I've already made today and kind of explain a little bit what Trump is trying to do and his methodology. First of all, at the inauguration, I absolutely was in hog heaven at the inauguration. I mean, it was amazing, it was beautiful, it was patriotic. Everybody in D.C., even the legislators, they just all seem to have this bounce in their step. Whereas, like, you know, we can actually get things done now. We don't have to be in this gridlock. We're going to have a president that's going to come down here, and he's going to make things happen. And it was amazing. Some of the video that you've kind of seen on TV about some of the empty crowds and all that kind of good stuff, I didn't feel that. I didn't sense that. And kind of getting some stories. There were protesters actually lined up at several gates that chained themselves, so they had to shut down the gate. There were people that had some of the stand-up seats as well as some of the seats where you sit down. They just could not make it through. They're not. Yeah.
I mean, I got to be back, but I had a good time twice. We had some good places.
Yeah, you could make it.
Well, they closed the gate.
Yeah, exactly. So
the blue gate.
Yeah, the blue gate.
I got in the blue gate.
Yeah,
exactly. It wasn't my blue gate.
You experienced that as well?
Same thing, and also the police officers were like, "I'd love to let you in, but I can't because I feel like you would be in danger."
Exactly. So there were a lot of people there. So we'll see if I'm leaving the media. One of the more interesting things that happened to us was it was the next night after the inauguration. We were sitting in a restaurant, and it was a really nice restaurant, and there were several windows that were busted out. It was from the rioting that was going on the night before. But there were a lot of protesters that were eating dinner in the restaurant that they busted. Yeah, the pink hats. Exactly.
That was the Women's March.
Exactly.
Because I got off the metro and ended up in that to get out of a hat to even get to the side street to get back to the lawn.
Yeah. So that was just kind of an interesting mix where I was sitting there with some protesters who the protesters before them busted all the windows in the restaurant they're eating. So
what's the name of the restaurant? Do you remember?
I don't remember. No, I'm horrible.
It wasn't a chain.
No, it was a local restaurant. But some of the things I just want to kind of go over really quick is Donald Trump. What I really, really like about Donald Trump is he is one of the few elected officials that actually does what he says he's going to do.
Mm-hmm. Right.
You know, and right from the beginning. And who here has kind of gone through the list of executive orders that he's gone through?
Yeah, he just did one right now.
Okay.
He just did another one right now. No welfare for immigrants.
Oh, yeah, I'll
buy it.
That's beautiful. That's beautiful.
Yeah. No earnings. Say that again. No what?
No welfare for illegal immigrants. That's
awesome. The Johnson
Amendment.
The Johnson Amendment.
I did. He did that one also. Yeah, I just saw this one here. He was going to do that. I don't know when he signed that yet.
Well, what I want to do real quick is kind of go through some of the promises that he made out there on the campaign trail, and then the executive orders that he issued to kind of back up those promises. What I love about it is he's not waiting for Congress to act. How many times have you heard, "Well, I can't do this because Congress can't do that for Congress"? He's like, "Heck no to Congress. I'm going to go out there. I'm going to sign an executive order to show you guys, to show the people that didn't believe him in the first place, to show the people that he wasn't conservative enough that, yes, I am conservative. These are my beliefs." The very first thing that he signed was Proclamation 95570. It was a National Day of Patriotic Devotion. Pretty much every president since, I think, George W. Bush, made the day of inauguration a special day. What was different about this one was it wasn't necessarily about him. It was about the country. It was about America. I just want to read a few things. It says, "A new national pride stirs the American soul and inspires the American heart. We are one people united by a common destiny and a shared purpose. There are no greater people than the American citizenry As long as we believe in ourselves, in our country, there is nothing we cannot accomplish. That's what his was about. It was about the American people. It was about making America great again. Yeah. All right, what was another promise that he made?
Pipeline.
Excuse me?
Pipeline.
The pipeline, exactly. Talked about the pipeline. Talked about energy independence. He talked about, you know, we're going to, whatever energy is out there that we can get, let's go ahead and get it. And how many orders did he sign? There was a couple of them. He signed the Keystone Pipeline. Worth it on him.
20 so far. 21, I believe, now.
Well, it just had to do with the energy. There was the Dakota Pipeline, mm-hmm. and he also signed one where he asked, he's asking the Secretary of Commerce if he can make it that when they build these pipelines, they have to use American steel. Okay? I don't know if he can do that or not, but nonetheless, he's trying. Okay? So again, energy independence, the Keystone Pipeline. What's another promise that he's made?
The wall.
The wall. Exactly. Making America safe. Talking about making America safe again. He issued the executive order to build the wall. What else did he do as far as making America safe again?
Chicago. He said he would help send in the feds to Chicago.
Exactly, sanctuary cities. Pretty much stripped all the funding for sanctuary cities, so we can't do that. We can't do that anymore.
Yeah, but also the gangs.
The gangs? Yeah. You're talking about Detroit.
Minister yesterday said that he's working with the gangs to talk to Trump about the body count going down in Chicago.
Yeah. So, I mean, I've come right back up. The other one to kind of make America safe was the ban on seven countries.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Now, what's the media doing with that?
Oh, having a field day.
They are having a field day with that. Now, I'm going to kind of step aside, but I'm going to go down a different track for just a moment. I'll come back to this. The media and the alt-left, all right? Who here has thought themselves or has somebody asked them, will Donald Trump just stop tweeting? Can you just stop
my mom.
The tweeting?
I love the tweeting.
I get that almost every day. You know, I like the guy. I think he's doing a good job. But can he just stop the tweeting? Let me tell you guys, he is not going to stop the tweeting. Okay. He's not. Now, but there's logic, there's rationale behind this. What does the media and the alt-left do with his tweets? They take it and they run. And then what's going through their head is, okay, this guy is extreme. This guy is crazy. This guy is nuts. But he got elected. How is that possible? Well, you know what? We have to be equally as extreme and nuts and crazy, but on the other side to win this thing back. So what Donald Trump is doing, he's letting them kind of think he's over here so they can go way over here. But what does he do?
He's
right here in the middle.
Yep.
He's right here where all the rest of us think, man, the guy tweets a little bit crazy, but he's really doing a good job. Yep. And when he gets America to think that, what are we going to start thinking about these protesters? They're going to become a nutso, and it's going to further divide them as he solidifies his base. Sure. So while it kind of seems a little bit crazy when you break down exactly what he's doing, it's really quite brilliant. And I knew that to begin with. No, I'm just kidding. What's another promise that he's made?
Oh, term limits on senators and congressmen up in Washington.
Okay. I don't know if an executive order that's actually done.
No, not yet.
Not yet. But he has talked about draining the swamp. Mm-hmm. All right. He talked about draining the swamp. And to do that, he did the executive order that pretty much bans anybody in his administration from lobbying for foreign countries. And he's put a 5-year ban exactly on other lobbyists.
Right.
And then also, along with draining the swamp, just kind of shrinking the size of government. You know, he's put a freeze on hiring people. He's also asked all the department agencies what we can do to reduce the number of employees in our government. So he's kind of doing that. And kind of going back to your earlier comment about Detroit and the inner cities, education. Education is the key to some of these inner cities, getting them educated and helping them feel like there's opportunities for them outside of the environment that they grew up in. Because if there's no hope for these inner cities, there's nothing that anybody can do to help them get out. And one thing that he did that no other president has done is last week as National School Choice Week.
Mm-hmm.
That was a huge, huge win for those people that actually want to take control of their children's education.
Mm-hmm. Right. Yeah.
And so what's one more promise? I don't want to take too much time. What's one more promise that he made?
National prayer. I mean, he's doing more with prayer breakfasts and prayer and stuff like that.
Freedom of religion.
Okay, freedom of religion.
And I don't want to say that in order, but he was very vocal about the
that's there.
Exactly.
Now, that's huge.
Yeah. Yes. How many presidents have actually gone in there?
Never.
Not a single one. Pence was there. He was in support of it. Not only that, he also did a memorandum. It's called the Mexico City Policy. Anybody familiar with that?
Oh, yes. No funding for...
No federal funding can go to any foreign entity that supports Planned Parenting that endorses abortions.
Right.
No more of that. How conservative is that for you guys? All right. I'm telling you.
The thing that impressed me so, too, was that he fired Attorney General, but she didn't...
Yeah.
Exactly. He's like, I'm not going to have any of this.
Delegates.
Yeah, I'm not going to have any of this stuff.
And he put someone right back in the place as soon as he found it. I thought that was
nasty. Have y'all heard that she might run for next governor?
Yeah, I heard that. Yeah.
I would love for her to run. Love for her to run. I think she could be very handily beat it.
How about no federal funding for sanctuary cities?
Exactly. Yeah. He did that. He put that out there as well. So
yeah, but about California now. California wants to become the sanctuary state.
Well, I've heard they want to emancipate, they want to succeed. Yeah.
I
have a thing about that.
Set up in Mexico.
Sure.
Here's the thing about that. I have to say to these idiots. Did I say? I have to say with these people. They say that he lost by 3 million votes. Okay, but without California, he loses. But he wins by 1.4 million.
Exactly.
Now here's the deal with something like that. What if California is so big? You want to secede? Isn't it just making it easier for us in the second election?
Exactly.
In 2018, it's like we already won by 1.4 million, but you want to get rid of California?
Exactly. The state that would carry
the election. Okay, it'll be like Governor Nixon in 72.
I know there is one more that I want to talk about. One more promise that he made. That was again the military. You know, he has promised to strengthen our military, and he's done that. You know, there's been several different orders. Basically, the biggest one was for him. He's asked all of his departments, his military departments, to go out and assess where we are militarily, including our nuclear arsenal, and what it's going to take to strengthen our military. So, absolutely love what our president is doing. I think he is going to fulfill these promises. I think he laid out his map, what he's going to do. Now, the next 190 days, however long, he's going to work with Congress to help turn some of these executive orders into law. So that's what I think he's going to do, along with some other things that we mentioned today.
Look what the man did by getting on the plane and hit his daughter going over to the folks. The gentleman was killed.
To greet the family and the body came back.
Yes.
Today I heard about that Obama had already approved of this military plan, that he decided he was going to let Trump handle it. Well, Trump depended on his military advisors on what to do. So they're blaming him for loss of life and everything, but it's like, once again, the media is like stirring it all up. Did we hear anything that was Obama's okay?
No,
but I'm just saying,
yeah.
You know, it's like that, so.
So,
hey, Michael, can I make a suggestion with everybody? Everybody talks about the media. You know what the whole deal is? I have a suggestion for this. If anybody has Twitter or Facebook or any of these things right now, if you want fair journalism, fair, Ben Shapiro, if you guys have heard of him, look him up.
Sure.
And the reason being is because he wasn't a Trump guy, and he still, but he gives all credit, and he'll give all, and he gives all credit, and he'll give any kind of criticism that's necessary that would be necessary. But the thing is, he gives every bit of facts. He doesn't go in, and he is always the first right on the spot, almost even before Breitbart, on the news, even before everything, he always has the news right there. I mean, they've Ben Shapiro, look him up. He's 33 years old, he's around for
now. He does those alerts on your email.
It's called the Daily Wire. Right. It's like, if you want to do his, if you want to do his thing, you know, like his podcast or anything, it's $8 a month for a whole thing.
What area do you represent now in the Capitol?
I represent Forsyth County.
Oh, good. Yeah, Forsyth.
County in Forsyth County. Yeah.
I met you at the Trump Jr. event.
Yes, ma'am. Yeah. Any other questions I can answer for you?
Thank you very, very much.
All right.
Thank you. So if we could give each of our
presenters or panelists a minute each to summarize or wrap up. We'll go ahead and do that. And so starting with Mr. Williams.
Which one? Senator and Mr. I really just, when Kyle was talking about the new paradigm and not wanting to do predictions, that's something that I had thought of. The map has changed, my friends. The map has changed. I don't care if we lose California by 12 million popular votes. If we win Michigan, Wisconsin, and Pennsylvania, and there's a reason for that, my friend. The Democrat Party has stopped being the party of the working class, and they're now the party of the non-working class. And that's exactly what resonated this election. Just not to bore you with too much statistics, but I was debating some folks the other night about how much of a mandate does Trump really have. And I was like, you know, let me research what happened in the Midwest. So I took Wisconsin. I'm comparing Obama versus Romney to Trump versus Hillary. It's about a 9-point difference, folks. Obama won in 2012 about 53% to 46%. This past cycle, Trump got 47%, which is 2 points ahead of Romney. No, Romney got 45, it was 53 to 45. So Trump was 2 points better than Romney. Hillary Clinton got 45%, so she was 7 points from Obama. So that is a 9-point swing right there. That is who decided the election. I don't care what the California crazies do. They do not have the moral compass in this country, but the Midwest does. And that's exactly who voted Republicans. And I see that trend continuing. So thank you, guys.
Thank you, Greg. And Mr. Wingfield, would you like to have a close with a final thought?
I think it's going to be fascinating to see what his priorities are. We've seen some of that in the executive orders, but as we were talking about, we're going to move toward the legislature having more of a say in that. I know that a lot of people at the Capitol are going to be very interested to see what happens on health care, because it affects a huge part of our budget here in Georgia. And there's a lot of promise there, I think, with Tom Price leading that up, and some of the ideas that are out there could be really good. But I think you're going to continue to see big things happening and changes, and some of it will probably be, I don't want to say difficult to swallow. I think it's going to be unnerving at times, because the kinds of things that we're talking about doing are very different. And I'm talking about things that I think most of us in this room would agree with, like, for instance, some of the changes that we might see on healthcare. So when you see those coming out and you think about the ways it might be different, give it some time to kind of sit and evaluate before you start jumping to conclusions, because I think, if we move in a really more free market way on healthcare, that's going to be unnerving to a lot of people, but ultimately I think it puts us in a better position, so we'll hopefully see some of that coming out.
Uh-huh. Thank you very much. And Senator Williams, would you please bring it home with final remarks?
I guess the last thing I would like to say is kind of an action item. One, we have a great opportunity in our country to take it back, to bring back American pride, American exceptionalism. And us here in this room, we need to be the leaders and the examples of that. Talk to your friends, talk to your neighbors, but make sure that you don't be one of those guys or those gals that the media left can take and say, you see, they're crazy. We all know, so kind of think before you tweet, think before you post on Facebook. We have a great opportunity. We don't need to feed the left ammunition. Let's focus on what we all care about, which is our country, bringing it back home, and the things that we can unite behind. Because right now, there's this big group of people in the middle that don't know what to do. They don't like the left, but when they think about the right, they think about these crazy, crazy Christians. Mm-hmm. We have a lot in common with everybody, and let's focus on those commonalities instead of our differences. And thank you guys for loving me.
I just want to thank all of you for coming out to help us unite and heal the nation after a very, not so much divisive, but hard-fought political season. And we would be remiss if we didn't say, go Falcons! We picked the Giants to beat the Patriots twice, and they beat them twice, and we think the Falcons are a much better team. And as long as they keep the pressure on Tom Brady and control the football and keep it out of New England's hands, it sounds like a winning strategy.
We score more points. We're
feeling that 31 to 24 is a good final score.
How do you do a prediction?
Or maybe 38 to 31.
I don't want to jinx it.
So
38-34 Falcons.
Okay.
But we just want to also invite all of you over to the Doe Irish Pub if you have time afterward to for some fellowship. And coming up on Super Bowl Sunday, there will be lots of Super Bowl parties going on. I know Greg Williams has, I think, a house party going on.
I am, and you can find it on Facebook. It's at the corner of Houston Mill and La Vista Road. And just need to bring yourself. We're going to have all the other supplies.
And for those of you who want a smaller, quieter, more intimate group, some of them the Freedom Coalition.
No, it's just DJs. I just want people there.
Well, the Freedom Coalition will be meeting at the Lindbergh Chili's because it's quiet compared to the packed taco mac next door, which is standing room only, and you have to let one person out and let one person in. But it's quiet, and the food is good, and it's reasonably priced at the Chili's. So. From 6 to 9:30 or so, we'll be there. And if you want to come early and watch Bill O'Reilly interview Donald Trump at 4 o'clock, you can do that. But officially, 6 or 6:30 on, we'll be there, and you're very welcome. And if you know anyone else you want to invite, feel free to do that. Thank you very much. And so hopefully, as many of you as possible will be able to stay to go over to the Fido Irish Pub for fellowship. But also. The parking here in the library, it is free, but they do validate at the garage around the corner if you want to move over there. I think it's only like $5, I believe, if you want to stay where you park here in the library. And so that's up to you, but thank you, and God bless you.
Hey, great job, James. Thank you.